I'm going to start the recording. So I just start with the introduction. So hello everyone, this is an interview conducted by the Young Ambassador Program for the Environment Day. And today we have with us Rohit Sar, who are going to answer questions about sustainable emergency buildings. So hello Rohit. And can you please, for the first question, introduce yourself? So who are you and what do you do?
Hi, Nina. Thank you so much for having me here. It's an absolute pleasure to be able to talk to someone, you know, about these things that we are all very, very passionate about. So I am Rohit Sar. I am a recent undergrad graduate from an engineering college in India, the Indian Institute of Technology at Kharagpur. And I currently work as the chief operating officer for our NGO, which is Nostos Homes. So at Nostos, I essentially look after the entirety of the supply chain and operations aspects of really sourcing these houses, getting them designed, getting them constructed, and then also looking at transportation and deployment of these structures at places. So a little bit of background about Nostos, right? So there are about what? There are about 80 odd million people who are forcibly displaced globally every year. And they face realities that deny them a dignified life and the opportunity to fulfill many things that we take for granted, employment, education, even like the basic dignity and decency that people should be afforded in their day-to-day lives. And these people are stranded in like these sort of transient community shelters till aid agencies create new homes for them. And a process that with conversations with aid agencies, we've understood can take anywhere between 5 and 7 years. And in this period, lack of proper housing hampers not just the lack of a roof above their head, but everything from their health, their education, their employment, their psychological safety, and many other things. At Nostos, we build homes for the forcibly displaced to help them thrive. Our innovative homes are designed to serve as intermediate shelters for people who are displaced due to violent conflict, natural disasters, or anything else that would cause any sort of forcible displacement. And we are a team of 9. All of us are currently either alumni or existing students at the Indian Institute of Technology at Kharagpur. And we believe that it's not enough to merely shelter the displaced. And therefore, we look to deliver the whole package of really a home, which can be assembled sort of like Lego within a few hours by a group of people who practically have no exposure to anything technical in their lives. And that's really who we are. And that's the problem that we're looking to solve. I hope that answers your first question.
Yeah, thank you very much. So my second question will be, so what is for you a sustainable emergency building?
So when we looked at the design of Nostos, right, our biggest question was, why do we need something like this? I mean, the most prevalent design in this space, if you look at it, are your canvas tents. Or in even poorer communities, it's essentially your ad hoc shanty type shelters, right? Which is like sheets of rubberized tarpaulin that's often just, you know, draped over like bamboo poles or whatever, just to like provide some sort of a cover over one's head. Now, ultimately, there are a bunch of problems with these things, right? So number one, they're extremely fragile and they last for very, very short durations, right? And extremely heavy use in a poor weather environment at a very crowded refugee camp. You see canvas tents, lasting anywhere between just 6 months to a year. And the second thing is like, they're really, really heavy on a lot of plastic materials or otherwise, even a lot of other shanty constructions that happen are primarily with wood, right? And when we looked at the design of Nostos homes, we essentially decided that a few things had to hold. First, you know, we had to use materials that were recyclable in nature. Second, these houses should last like significantly longer. Like currently we estimate our houses to have a full life cycle of at least 10 years because of the materials that we use to construct them. I'll get to that in a bit. And also, they should definitely not be like one use and throwaway kind of solutions. These are houses that should be resilient enough to survive multiple deployments and redeployments and all of the transportation and storage and handling that comes in between subsequent deployments so that, you know, with a one-time effort of building something, we are actually able to use it for a very, very long time. So our houses are essentially made out of like hollow steel frames. That's really what the structure is. And we look at sandwich panels made of insulating material to provide the walls, doors, and the roofing. So 90% of the house by weight is the steel. All of that is very practically recyclable in nature. There's really no wood or natural materials that are used in the construction of our houses at any point of time. And we think that they meet these three criteria, right? Of having recyclable material, of having durability to survive for a long enough duration, to really, you know, sustain the input that's gone into building them the first time. And also the fact that they're reusable and redeployable and they're resilient enough for them. So we sort of thought, these are like the three parameters that we really need to look at. And not only does it work from like an environmental sustainability standpoint, but it's also very financially sustainable in that the amortized cost of housing people in these houses over a 10 to 15 year period actually works out to be the same cost as if you were using canvas tents and instead changing them once every 6 months. And that's where we think this solution is a real win in terms of sustainability. And that's how I would think, sustainable buildings of this nature should be looked at. There definitely might be other ways, but this is how we've decided to look at it at Nostos.
Okay, thank you very much. This was really clear. I have a third question. So do you think there is any environmental risk associated with the construction of these buildings? Maybe during the construction, I don't know.
Right. So primarily the houses are pretty safe to build, right? Because they're relatively lightweight structures and it's never like, you're raising an entire roof or you're putting up an entire wall in one go. Like if you look at traditionally how a lot of your prefabricated flat pack structures are constructed, you will typically have the floor, then you will have the four walls folded on top of the floor, and then you'll have the entire roof. Construction of this nature would require an experienced team of people. It would require some use of scaffolding. It would require like a crane or something to lift the roof. And that's like a non-trivial weight if you're lifting that entire structure. Whereas for our house, every single wall panel, window, door, every column and every beam that ultimately makes up the constituent parts of the house are provided as each is, are provided individually. So you literally build the house element by element. So we really don't have people handling very, very heavy weights at any single point of time. And that's primarily also the reason why you avoid the use of like heavy machinery and cranes or any sort of like power tools, etc. So, a group of 4 to 6 people could very easily assemble this house with nothing but like a couple of hammers, like pickaxes to dig the ground and sink the foundations, and then just spanners and wrenches to bolt all of the different structural elements together. The panels and the doors, the windows, they all sort of push fit into different channels that are cut out into the panels, into the wall, into the frames, the roof frames, the wall columns, etc. And the beams and columns and all of the steel structures themselves, they basically get joined together and then bolted. So there's no welding involved. There's no cutting or use of any sort of power tools on site, right? And we're not even dealing with any sort of heavy structural loads at a time. So on those grounds, yeah, we do think that it is safe for people to go ahead and construct these houses with minimal training, just following like a very detailed visual guide that we'd be providing with the houses. And we don't really see any such environmental risk. We've gone out of our way to ensure that the house is made of materials which are either straight up fireproof, such as the steel, or fire retardant as per prevalent government certification requirements in terms of the polymer material with which the wall panels and the roofing, etc., is built. So I think on all of those grounds, there aren't really any very apparent environmental risks that come with these structures.
Okay, thank you very much. My fourth question will be, so do you think that today this construction of emergency building, sustainable emergency building, is indispensable?
So if you sort of look at the situation in the world today, right, and why talk about the entirety of the world? I mean, if I could just talk about India, right? You know, there are close to 5 million people who get displaced each and every year due to various environmental disasters that keep occurring in a country as large as ours, right? Mm-hmm. With a very diverse ecosystem, like ranging from mountains to river plains to coastal areas, you have everything from earthquakes to cyclones to routine floodings of perennial rivers. And that's just something that is now a fact of life for people who live here. So in terms of certain statistics, so about 5 million people get displaced each year. Out of that, about 2 million are just due to flooding in like the northern floodplains of India, right? Which is where our biggest, most perennial rivers like the Ganga, the Ganges, etc. keep flowing. And if you look at certain disasters which have caught like a lot of limelight because of the severity in the recent days, such as the floods in the northeast of India, specifically in the state of Assam in the last couple of years. So 7 million people were displaced, but only a few hundred thousand of them were able to get relief in government aided camps. And even in those camps, people ultimately received, you know, very poor quality of housing. And even as we've gone ahead and we sort of started looking at what really exists in the terms of relief housing or in terms of, you know, other sort of emergency use buildings, right? It's absolutely pathetic. We were talking to some NGOs in Nagaland, a remote state in the northeast, in the extreme northeast of Assam, right near the Burma or the Myanmar border. And they were talking to us about how we could use these houses to, you know, provide for supplementary care centers to the existing public health centers, right? The government provided public health centers, which are there at like a provincial or at a county level for people in these areas. And the buildings that are today used as public healthcare centers were like a year ago being used as pigsties and cowsheds. And that's really how bad the problem is in terms of the lack of infrastructure.
Yeah.
So what this sort of tells us is that this is a problem that's really not being addressed, that it's sort of like accepted that, you know, we really can't do better than providing people with shanty type housings or provide people with canvas tents, which really don't provide the kind of aid that we think these people deserve at this point of time, which is why we think, you know, sustainable housing like the kind that Nostos is working to build, it fits a really, really big gap in the entire disaster rehabilitation and rebuilding space. And we do think that this is something that will become, or we at least we hope that it is something that will become indispensable with time as more and more people see the practicality and the utility and the value that this solution can provide to the stakeholders as well as the relief providers.
Yeah, right. It's really true. So as a last question I asked, what do you think is an action that someone can take today, right now, just after they watch this interview to help the environment?
So that's a really interesting question. And I think that's a question that's really close to all our hearts at Nostos, because that's very, very closely linked to how this organization came up. So one of our co-founders, Kaushal Shetty, who happens to be an architecture major from the Indian Institute of Technology at Kharagpur, is the one who came up with the original concept design for what is now known as a Nostos home. And Kaushal basically submitted this as his final year thesis project as an architecture student. And where the inspiration for this really came from is that when Kaushal was growing up as a child, he grew up in an extremely flood-prone area in the very south of India, in a relatively rural provincial area in the south of India called Udupi. And that's where Kaushal grew. And the local river in their county would flood like a couple of times a year on a routine basis. And while Kaushal's family was relatively better off and they had, you know, like slightly more permanent concrete housing, and they were able to manage with water logging and the flooding around them, a lot of the villagers who lived in semi-permanent houses or earthen houses or thatched houses, they lost their houses, lost their belongings year on year, routinely got displaced, and they remained in like a perpetual state, a perennial state of poverty. Because they'd spend 1 year rebuilding, and then the second year, they'd literally just go back to where they started, and they'd be stuck in the survival loop. So of course, Kaushal and his family did prosper. They did move out. They went to Mumbai, which is of course one of the largest cities in India, and they became urbanized. But this is sort of like a memory that stuck with Kaushal that really inspired the kind of work that he did as an architecture student at IIT, and then also led to the inception of Nostos Homes. So what I'm really trying to drive from this is there isn't any very specific thing that we would ask someone, that I would at least ask someone to do, right? I think that'd be extremely presumptuous and quite unfair of me to imagine what context is specific to someone depending on where they're from and what they have to go through. But typically, I think if you just look at the environment around you, and if not yourself, but at least the community that you live in, I think there are a lot of things that you can do to help with environmental factors that are today causing hardship to the people who live around you. Whether that's to do with waste recycling, whether that's to do with waste management, whether that's to do with simple things like rainwater harvesting, starting like a community solar project, or doing something like Kaushal did, which is, you know, sort of conceptualize and build an entire solution for an unsolved problem from scratch. I think these are all things that can be done. When we started out with this idea, we had no funding, we had nothing. And we just decided that, you know, this seems like a good idea. We think it has merits. We went around, we showed it to a few people at like the World Bank, etc. And they bought the idea and they encouraged us to go ahead and do it. So I think there are a lot of good ideas for people to work on. And there are also a lot of good people who can help you, support you, and encourage you to do this kind of work. And I think it's just important for people to identify what's specific to the context of who they are, where they live, and what their community really needs. And it doesn't take a lot to start off with helping. And then you never know how far or how big that thing can really get. I hope that like answers your question.
Yeah, thank you very much for all your answer and for this interview. It was great. I'm going to stop the recording.